Hi, it's Mayor Nahidnenshi here. And you know, normally the first week of June is one of my favorite times of year to be at City Hall because the Mayor's Environment Expo takes over the whole place. Hundreds of students and teachers and parents and exhibitors all talking about how we can keep our land, our air, and our water clean and safe for everyone. Of course, it's a little different this year again because we can't be together. But nonetheless, so many folks have worked so hard to make sure that you have the opportunity to still have a great Mayor's Environment Expo and to learn about all the ways that you can help the environment. So a special thank you to all of my colleagues at the City of Calgary who've come together to put this on. A thank you to our venue partners at the Calgary Public Library and the University of Calgary School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape for putting this all together. Et je comprends aussi qu'il y a des sessions en français cette année, et c'est merveilleux, bravo pour étudier en français et pour apprendre toutes les choses qu'on peut faire pour améliorer l'environnement. And my best thanks, of course, go to the teachers who worked hard to make this work within their crazy world of changing how they teach, and especially a thank you to all of the students involved. I know this has been a really rough year. I know that we've had to learn completely new ways of doing things and new ways of learning, but I also know that young people have shown that they are truly resilient, that students are focusing on what really matters and how we move forward. And especially in this time of climate change, one of the things that really matters is all of our responsibility to the environment. So have a great virtual Mayor's Environment Expo, everyone.
Heather, you're live. Good morning, everybody. My name is Heather McCubbin. I work with the Environment and Parks in the Government of Alberta. And my coworker is Diesel, who is sitting there beside me in that picture. And Diesel and I work with the Aquatic Invasive Species Program. So we've been partnered together for 6 years and to help make sure that the spread of aquatic invasive species is not happening here in the province. So you guys can come with me for the next hour and we'll dive into Diesel's job, my job as a canine handler, and learn a little bit more about our Don't Let It Loose program. So here in the Government of Alberta, we've had the Aquatic Invasive Species Program since 2013. And I've been a part of it since 2014. Now, Diesel and I have been partnered together since the dogs have been incorporated into the program back in 2015. So there's been a lot going on over the years. We've had an increase of inspection stations along our province borders. We've had inspection stations at our water bodies. And then the incorporation of using the dogs to help our program just as another tool. So if we're going to talk about invasive species, what exactly are invasive species? Now, what we're going to be talking about specifically is the aquatic invasive species. So anything that can impact our waterways. But in general, invasive species are non-native species that significantly modifies or disrupts our ecosystem. So any species that is coming from another location that is native there, that is not native here. Whether that is a species coming from Fort McMurray, Grand Prairie area and coming to Calgary, or a species that is coming from Europe or Asia and coming to Canada. Doesn't matter how far it's coming from, it just means that it is not native here to Calgary or to Alberta. Now, aquatic invasive species is one of the leading causes of biodiversity loss. And in Canada, we have 60% of the world's fresh water. So we're trying very hard to make sure that we can protect that. They are expanding their range and threatening both the economy, the environment, and the health of humans. So in Alberta, we have many species that we're keeping an eye on, and that is including 52 prohibited species that are listed in the Alberta Fisheries Act. So this is just a few of them that we're going to talk about. In the top picture there, we have marbled crayfish. It is actually able to clone itself. We have flowering rush, which actually doesn't look too bad. It's very pretty. But as it grows along the shoreline, it can just make a carpet and take away that riparian area. We have the American bullfrog, another species that does not belong here in Alberta. Now, the last three pictures there, we are going to talk a little bit more about throughout the presentation, including your goldfish that could be in your fish tanks at home. Now, goldfish are okay in your fish tanks at home as pets, but they do not belong in our local lakes. Now, the last two pictures is what Diesel and I work with. Eurasian water milfoil is an invasive weed. It is invasive in BC and is still in BC, but it is not here in Alberta. So we are trying our best to make sure that we are checking all watercrafts for weeds and make sure that they're not bringing Eurasian water milfoil into Alberta. Zebra quagga mussels is our biggest threat right now and the biggest one that we are concerned about. So zebra mussels, as pictured in that picture, came into North America in the 80s through the Great Lakes, and they have now spread throughout North America. And most recently, 2013, they showed up in Manitoba. So it took them about 20, 35 years to jump from Ontario to Manitoba. But every year we are a lot more concerned with the amount of boats that are moving around the province and the country. So zebra and quagga mussels can be very, very small. They can just be the size of a grain of rice. An adult mussel can produce over 1 million young per year or per season. So Lake Winnipeg got mussels in 2013, as I said, and the beaches there are no longer walkable, being barefoot. This is showing to be an environmental, and causes impacts to our recreation. So mussels have little threads that on the bottom called bissel threads. And those threads help them to attach this hard surfaces. Now I say hard surfaces very lightly because I've seen life jackets, ropes, and even buoys that are completely attached with mussels. And those aren't exactly hard surfaces. So the recreation impact here is the damage to our fisheries, as well as all of our motors and recreational equipment. And because of those bissel threads, they can attach and clog all different types of pipes and equipment. And so we need to make sure that we can keep all that equipment clean. So here's a nice picture of a lake. This picture was taken in Kansas in 2003. It looks very similar to a lot of our lakes and reservoirs here in Alberta. Nice rocky shore, still able to walk on that barefoot. It may not be very comfortable, but it is doable. Just three years later, in 2006, one of my coworkers down in the States took this same picture. This is the same water body on the same beach, just a little bit more zoomed in. As you can see, the mussels are attaching to rocks and surfaces, as well as to each other. And so they have caked that entire shoreline. Not something that you guys want to walk on here in Alberta. So currently this is the status of the zebra and quagga mussels in North America. As you can see, when they came through the Great Lakes, in about 1985, and they have then spread since then. So we've seen lots of populations in the east, but over the years things have happened and they are moving west. So with the occurrence of mussels now in Lake Winnipeg, as well as some possible occurrences in Montana, Alberta is now on high alert. So Diesel and I work at Aquatic Invasive Species watercraft inspection stations. You might see them along our highways. We are inspecting all types of watercrafts and making sure that we aim to tell everybody to clean, drain, and dry. And that goes for any gear and any thing that might go in the water. So the picture on the left there shows how the mussels came into the Great Lakes. The big ballast picked up the water when they were in the European waterways. And then when they came over here, they let go of all that water. The same concept with all the wakeboard boats and ski boats when we have ballast in our boat. All that water cannot be completely drained in most of those systems. So we need to make sure that we flush it with hot water to decontaminate any water that might be holding any microscopic mussels. So of course, you all want to see how the inspection stations work and specifically how diesel works and is involved in the system. And because I'm doing this presentation virtually for you, the only way I can do that is with this video. So I hope you guys can see how the dogs can sniff out for invasive species.
Heather, you're live.
So we found mussels on all types of boats, watercrafts, wakeboards, jet skis, sailboats, and even kayaks. But as you guys can see, dogs' noses can go places that humans' eyes can't really go. But with only three dogs in the province, we have to count on the team as a whole. So we have a team of about 30 watercraft inspectors around the province, and so we work as a team together. So the dogs are just another tool in the toolbox. So like I said, we're inspecting all different types of watercrafts and all the toys, waders, and everything else that goes in contact with the water. Even the very big boats. And of course, this boat was infested with fish eggs on the bottom. This boat was coming from Saskatchewan and heading to Okanagan Lake, So even though the fish eggs were not an invasive species, we are making sure that all boats are clean, drained, and dried. So all things that could be attached to the boats need to be removed. And like I said, anything that comes in contact with the water. So we've got float planes as well. So they're traveling around the province and moving from one area or jurisdiction to another, maybe even coming up from the United States and landing here in Canada. So when you have especially forest fire planes that are picking up water and moving it around, we need to make sure that those areas are clean as well. Now the picture on the right is actually an underwater robot. In Alberta, we have lots of dams and other infrastructure in our waters that we need to make sure that we are able to maintain. So underwater robots can make that fixes to damage to our dams or just update and maintenance, but we don't actually own those machines. Those come from the state. So if they were in a water body that came from an area that had mussels in it, we need to inspect that. So Diesel actually did find mussels on this underwater robot, and so it had to be cleaned and decontaminated before it did work in our Alberta waterways. So even docks that get pulled out in the winter, we need to inspect those as well. And of course, we are working in all different types of weather, from the 35 degree heat wave here in June to the snowstorm that we had 2 weeks ago. We are out there making sure that boats are not bringing in those invasive species. So now that you've seen the dogs in action at the inspection stations, we also move around a lot. So like I said, with only the three dogs, we have a really big province to cover. Stations, events, but then also shorelines. So this video was taken in Lake Winnipeg. And so now the dogs are trained to sniff out for the same invasive mussels, not on a boat, but on a shoreline.
So let's take them to where you want to start. This is like acting like a mock real search and practicing for shoreline for the future.
Heather, your life.
So now that you guys have all met the dogs virtually, I thought I'd tell you a little bit more about them. So all three of our dogs were actually rescues. So Hilo was actually already had a job. He, at 1 year old, was bred for guide dogs for the blind in San Rafael, California. And that turned out not to be the job for him. So all of these conservation dogs are very high energy, high drive. They want to do something. They want to work. So Hilo was not meant to be a guide dog. He was bouncing off the walls, even a year old. They couldn't get him to calm down and focus. So they knew that he needed a different job. So the trainers at Guide Dogs reached out to our trainers at Working Dogs for Conservation and said that they had a candidate for our program. Zeus and Diesel, on the other hand, were partnered through Rescues to the Rescue. Also very high energy, high drive, and were in shelters and really wanted to do a job. So Diesel and Zeus knew that they had something special when we came along and they got to work for a ball. So that is the reward, as you guys saw in the videos. Every time that they find the target that they're looking for, they get rewarded with their favorite toy. It doesn't seem to matter too much. Maybe Zeus will disagree with me. What kind of toy that they get, as long as Zeus and Hilo get a ball and then they get to munch it or tug with you, they're happy. Diesel, on the other hand, is very adamant that his squeaky ball has to squeak. So if his squeaky tennis ball gets dropped in the lake, whether it's by myself or by him, he doesn't want to work anymore. So I have to give him a brand new ball that squeaks. So he makes sure that I am always prepared with multiple squeaky tennis balls. So we do ongoing training, not just the training that we got done with initially back in 2015. And it's very important for the dogs because they think it's just another game. So Hilo there on your right is sitting in front of what we call a scent wall. It's got multiple holes, just like there is holes on boats. And he has to sniff each individual hole. He has told us by sitting down that there is muscles in that top hole. Once they do that passive alert and sit down, then we can throw balls at him and he gets so excited. Whereas Diesel on the left is actually sniffing microscopic muscles. So each one of those buckets is filled with water. And this was a study that was done with U.S. Fish and Wildlife in Texas. And we were determining whether the dogs were actually able to tell us about microscopic muscles. So we were able to fill some of these buckets up with tap water or lake water from a lake that is known not to have muscles or lake water that has muscles. And he was able to tell us which bucket came from a lake that had mussels in it. So that was a very cool project. So like I said, training helps to create that dog handler bond. We've done work to get the dog comfortable with using us as supports when they have to jump up high, or doing tricks to get the dogs to get comfortable going under surfaces, especially when they have to inspect under a boat. Now for Zeus, he was number one, scared of people for the longest time. So opposite of a normal German Shepherd reaction. And he was also scared of different surfaces. So the paint on the sidewalks or grates on the ground. So we've done a lot of work, or I shall say Hannah, his handler, has done a lot of work with him over the years to increase his confidence. So the next video I would like to show you guys is actually a project that we did in Fish Creek Park in Calgary. So this was an invasive weed that was determined to only be found in Fish Creek Park. And this video I love because it shows the training stages when we're introducing a new target to the dogs. So my behind the scenes partner is going to get that ready for you guys right now. Thank you.
Heather, you're live.
So that was really interesting for me, even to look back on now. It was their second target, and it was very interesting going from a very detailed boat search to now being in the forest and looking for a plant. So at the beginning, they kind of thought, am I on a dog walk? What's really going on here? And that's why I love showing that video to show the stages of the training, of the progression of the new scent. But the dog handler bond is very strong. So we live together, have days off together, and of course have fun together. So they are just dogs. They need to have their days off too. So just like you guys really enjoy your weekends, so does Diesel enjoy his downtime as well. He loves playing frisbee, hanging out in the canoe, or even sitting in the backyard staring at bugs. So another part of our program that the dogs aren't really a part of is the Don't Let It Loose program. Now this is targeting our aquarium, bait fish, sport fish, live food, and water garden trades. So if you look at these pictures, you can see some of these things that might ring a bell, such as the crabs in our grocery store, the goldfish in our pet stores, live bait, and of course, aquarium plants. All of these things do not belong in our natural environment. So I'm going to show this picture once again that I showed at the beginning. So we've talked a little bit there about our Eurasian water milfoil and our zebra and quagga mussels, which is our targeted species that we're looking for at our boat inspection stations. Now, there are those 52 other prohibited species in Alberta listed on the Alberta Fisheries Act, targeting the flowering rush, this spotted crayfish, but then primarily our goldfish is what the Don't Let It Loose program was originally for. So the Don't Let It Loose program, like I said, is about goldfish, or Prussian carp is wild goldfish. Now I love showing this picture. It is mind-blowing to think of a goldfish that could have been in your fish tank is now the size of a chihuahua. We've been doing some projects all over the province to make sure that we are capturing and of course killing the wild goldfish that is out there. So this is a little wanted poster that you might see up at any fish and wildlife office in the province. If you know the species that you've caught, so make sure you know your identification properly, any Prussian carp can be killed. You don't let it loose. If you kill it, do not dispose of it back into the water body, okay? These fish are then outcompeting our native fish populations. They're eating all the good nutrients in the water. They're eating our smaller fish out there, and there's nothing eating it. So they are just eating and eating and eating, which means they are getting ginormous. So this is happening all over the province. It's not just happening up in Fort McMurray. It is happening right there in Calgary. Okay, I said sorry right there because I am not currently in Calgary. Now, you might be wondering how this is happening. This is primarily happening because of intentional release. So if you don't want your goldfish anymore, some people are releasing it into their local stormwater ponds or even flushing it down the toilet. So we are really trying to encourage people not to do that. So some of these signs are actually out at local ponds and lakes, making sure that nobody is dumping water or any species into the water bodies. Now I say don't throw it down the toilet as well, because some people think that when the fish is dead, that is fine. Unfortunately, nowadays, our systems are all interconnected. So the water that could be in your fish tank or the dead fish might be holding other diseases, parasites that could still be surviving. All of that water needs to be dumped into a gravel pit or a garden, somewhere where the water can slowly dissipate into the system and not go directly into the water. Like I said, that germs and diseases, all that microscopic organisms that could be in the water, murky water, and of course, anything that is alive can be taking over our native fish habitat, especially those goldfish that are outcompeting our native species. So if you have a goldfish at home and you don't want it anymore and it's still alive, you can either take it back to the pet store, as most of our pet stores in the province have now agreed to do that. You can try to rehome it like you would for a larger animal as well. So there are other ways to dispose of pets that you don't want anymore, rather than releasing them into the environment. So like I said, Prussian carp is wild goldfish. It is a species that when you capture it, you can just kill it and dispose of it. Some people have decided they want to eat it. I have never tried. But make sure that when you are catching fish, you do know your identification. If you are in Calgary and you go down to the Bow Habitat Station, they are actually have available those biodegradable fish caskets. So there are times that your fish do die and you need to dispose of them. You can either put them in the garbage or you can have a little funeral with them. And that's why we have these biodegradable fish caskets now available. Now, when you guys are out fishing with your parents or out on a walk or something, and you see a species that you think is invasive, there is the Alberta Invasive Species Council now has an updated EDMAPS, and this helps you guys become scientists out there as well. So you can take in a picture of it, identify with all the characteristics that you can think of. There's a little note section in there as well, and submit it. And then we actually have scientists that follow up, and then that helps us to know where all the invasive species are actually located. So I'm sure you guys have lots of questions about the aquatic invasive species, zebra and quagga mussels, or Theseum, the plant in Fish Creek Park, what the dogs are doing now, and of course, maybe our newest project, which has been the dogs searching for wild boar scat. So I can let you guys start putting questions in the chat box, but I thought you might want to see Diesel in action as well. So I'm going to go back to my main screen and I'm going to get Diesel to do a little demo for you guys right now. So in that little demo, Diesel was trying to find the mussels, and the mussels, as you might have noticed, were in that pink tin. So all the other tins he had to learn to ignore and realize that they did not pay off. only the ones with the muscles paid off. I see we got some questions in our chat box here, so I hope I can answer all of them. We got a good amount of time left for this. So as of right now, we haven't found any animals that can destroy or eat the mussels. They've been in the Great Lakes for about 30 years. So the Great Lakes have done a lot of cycling. There's been die-offs of fish populations. And so there is no native predators here in North America for the mussels. They did come from Eurasia. And so there is the predators there, but then that would be introducing another invasive species. The videos are online on YouTube, and I can also share them with the Mayor's Expo coordinators, and they can probably pass them out as well. So Manitoba beaches, I have talked to a lot of homeowners, residents along the Manitoba beaches when I have been there, and they have told me that they don't walk on the beach there anymore barefoot. There isn't areas where it's totally caked in mussels, but there is a lot of mussels that get washed up on the shores. And the main reason people don't want to walk barefoot is because these mussels are razor sharp. You can cut your skin, even picking up a handful. I've cut my hand. So a lot of people want to wear water shoes, or they'll just go somewhere else to another beach that might not have mussels washing up in great population. So they're not considered poisonous. But like I said, nobody is, or no other species is eating the mussel. And I don't think anybody has tried to eat these mussels because they are so small. So the majority of the mussels in that very first early picture next to the quarter that we are finding here in Alberta are about the size of a grain of rice. Quagga mussels are bigger than zebra mussels. So they could be about the size of your thumbnail maybe. But that is still very large for us to find here. Why are people inspecting every boat and ship? So we are looking for all invasive species. Plants and mussels are our biggest concern because of the economic impact of the mussels. With those thistle threads, mussels can attach to all different surfaces, and with all the, I think it's about 8,000 kilometers of canals and pipelines with our irrigation districts, there is no way to get rid of the mussels when they're here. So that would be a lot of cleaning in order to keep up with maintaining that canal system. So we want to make sure that if boaters are using the irrigation canals and reservoirs, that they're not bringing in any invasive species. So as you can see, we have three different dogs. German Shepherd, Hilo is a black lab golden retriever cross, and Diesel is a chocolate Weimaraner. So it doesn't really matter the species of dog. Working Dogs for Conservation does use a lot of border collies and labs as well. All the dogs have in common is the high energy, high ball drive. They do not make very good house pets. Because they are bouncing off the wall. I can't just leave Diesel for 6 hours and go shopping or go to the city. By the way, I don't live in the city, so that where that comment comes from. Because he will destroy my house. He needs a project to do. He needs something focused. So that's why all three dogs, it doesn't really matter the breed, but their energy level does make a difference. There is only the three dogs in the province. They're about mid-career dogs now, being 7 years old. Hilo just turned 7 last week. And Diesel and Seuss are January and February birthdays. So I'm not really sure if the program will expand with our number of dogs in the future. But as of right now, Seuss is in the north near Edmonton. Hilo is in the central area and I'm in the south. As of right now, Alberta and BC are muscle free and we are trying our best to keep it that way. So we do shoreline searches here in Alberta, and that is to try to make sure that nothing has tried to sneak in. We don't have inspection stations open all year round. And so there is boaters that are still traveling with their boats in the wintertime. So if there is mussels that come through, then we'll do lots of water sampling and studying the lakes with the biologists to make sure that the population does not thrive. So if we find mussels or any invasive species at a watercraft inspection station, we have what we call land units. So they are big, basically water tanks that can get heated up. So they got a boiler on system and we are killing the mussels with hot water. So it's high pressure, like a car wash, hot water, and that'll kill the mussels, and then we remove them as well. So we try to do that on site. Sometimes circumstances are out of our control and that boater needs to keep on going. And so we try to make other arrangements if it is not able to be done on site when we intercept those mussels. As of right now, no mussels have been found on shorelines in Alberta. Like I said, we're still mussel free. But we do water monitoring and the dogs do shoreline searches to try to make sure that we are keeping up and updated with the status of mussels in the province. Where do the dogs live? So the dogs do live with our with their handlers. So Diesel lives with me, Cindy and Hilo live together, and Seuss lives with Hannah on her farm up north. So if I go to the office, Diesel comes with me. So I work 5 days a week and he comes with me, but I only put his work vest on when he's working. That keeps his brain knowing, okay, we're just doing this activity or whatever. But when I put the vest on, he knows he's going to work. He gets so excited. He wants to work for that tennis ball. So I think he likes coming to the office and everything as well, because it keeps him on his toes. So all dogs are colorblind. So it doesn't matter if I use a pink tin, a green tin, helps me to find out which one the mussels are in. Dogs can't do that. They have to use their nose. They have a lot more scent receptors in their nose than we do. And so that's how they're able to find the mussels. So all three of the dogs are now 7 years old. They were partnered with us when they were 1 year old. So we started the program in 2015, and that was a partnership with Working Dogs for Conservation, which is a nonprofit out of Montana, and California Fish and Wildlife. So Working Dogs for Conservation does projects all around the world. So when they got called by Rescue to the Rescues that they had a chocolate lab that could be perfect for our program, they went down there and they went and up and down the aisle of dogs at the shelter and they hold the ball. And this is the test to see if the dog can make a very good candidate. most dogs that want a home look at people. They have those, you know, good puppy dog eyes, and they'll look at that human and be like, pick me, take me, I need a home. A dog that would be a perfect detection dog looks at the toy. So Diesel was staring at that ball being like, oh my God, I want that ball. So they knew that that was number one, the first reason that you make a very good detection dog. So then they tested him, and the very first thing that he got to smell was actually elephant ivory. So Diesel was tested on elephant ivory, and if he didn't get in with our program, he would have gone to Africa to look out for elephant poachers. So he would have had a totally different career and avoiding all that winter snow. So what else do the dogs do? As handlers, we're always looking for different targets to keep the dogs excited for their job. So we have the muscle, zebra and quagga. So those are two separate species. I think you can call them cousins. The microscopic muscles that you can't see. You gotta, like all that bucket work we did with water. The rhythesium plant in Fish Creek Park. And now most recently, we have added wild boar scat. So wild boar is an invasive species here in Alberta as well, listed as a pest in the Agricultural Pests Act. And when they have determined to remove or believed to have removed wild boar from a specific area, they're going to send us in with the dogs, and the dogs are going to look for the wild boar scat. And if we find it, the dogs will get rewarded, then we can send it to the lab and it can get dated to see how old that scat or poop actually is. So that is a project we are actually able to do in the shoulder season. And the dogs can sniff for the poop under the snow as well. So that is something new for us as well. There is fines if people do not clean, drain, and dry their boats. Specifically, the specified penalties is if a boat inspection station is open and you skip the station, there is a fine for that. The other fine is for not removing the drain plug in your boat. So with your drain plug in, you're holding in all that water that could be in your boat that could be holding that microscopic organisms. So when you're at the boat launch, removing the plug, letting all the water drain out, and then you're not going to get, I believe it's $175 fine for the drain plug and $324 for skipping the station. So make sure you tell all your parents and everybody not to skip a boat inspection station if it is open. There are pesticides out there for invasive species. We have to get actual permission to use pesticides. And the biggest issue is using certain pesticides around water. So that is a permitting process that the other part of our program does. And that is targeting like flowering rush, pragmites, and other plants like that. So we haven't done that directly, as I am primarily focused on the boat inspection program with Diesel doing that. So mussels can't be removed when they're here. So once mussels come into an ecosystem, they're here for good. That's why looking at the map, it is very devastating to see almost all of North America has now been affected. Just this top northwest corner. So we have Saskatchewan, Alberta, and BC. As of now, no mussels that we are aware of. Washington, Idaho, Oregon, and Montana. But Montana has one lake that is still considered a suspect positive. So they had a population of mussels a couple years ago. that was determined by eDNA, and no mussels have been found since. So they are on the map as a suspect positive for 5 years until it gets removed. Unless we find something, then it changes. Diesel is 7 years old. So if a dog is searching for an invasive species on a boat and finds an illegal substance, I do not have the authority to confiscate them. So the dogs are only in looking for invasive species. At our boat inspection stations, we do have a sign that says what the dogs are looking for and what they're not looking for. But a lot of the times, every weekend, we have enforcement partners out there. So our stations are located at commercial vehicle weigh scales where the sheriffs are located as well. And we have fish and wildlife coming through all the time as well. So the dogs primarily do not look for anything that they're not trained on. They don't know how to tell us that there's something else there, but there is enforcement at our stations as well. Disposing of mussels, once we've killed them with the hot water, then they get sent up to the lab for sampling. So we send them up to the Edmonton lab and they determine whether the mussel was alive at the time of interception. After finding invasive plant species, how do you remove them all from the area? So unfortunately, we got really excited with the Theseum plants project in Calgary. As you can tell, I think Diesel's energy was off the charts. He was so excited about that project. But doing that project for two seasons in 2016 and 2017, we already realized that that plant was already widespread throughout the park. It was the first known location for that park in all of Canada. So we don't know if that came introduced through seeds on somebody's bottom of their shoe or through the CP rail system or how it got to Calgary. But it turned out that that part was already infested throughout the park. So as of right now, the City of Calgary and the park park managers, we're still trying to figure out how they're going to manage that species. Note the dogs are not blind. Working Dogs for Conservation does have a dog that is blind, and he wears like goggles when he is inspecting. They don't know if he's going to ever make a full inspection dog, because he is so high energy, bouncing off the walls, but he is also blind. So working around a boat, there is lots of sharps and rough edges. So it's really hard to keep the dog safe as well. We always want to keep both myself and the dog safe. So when we're doing shoreline searches and I'm maneuvering around docks, infrastructure, or even the big riprap rocks, I need to make sure that Diesel's got strong footing as well. Nothing is going to fall on him. Nothing's going to land on his feet. So I need to make sure that I am gauging his safety for the day and for long term. So like I said, that I work a 5-day work week and I gauge my hours, but his hours might be totally different. I need to see whether he's tired, he's not had enough for the day, energy level, or if there is a safety issue, especially when we have boats that are on big trailers, commercially hauled. Is it safe for the dog to inspect this boat? So that's where the teamwork of the 30 human inspectors comes in play. So the dogs are just another tool in the toolbox. Um, I haven't heard of other animals such as pigs or cats to detect invasive species. It would be interesting, especially in tighter spaces. Diesel is the smallest of the three dogs. But there is still times where, you know, I have to lift him up on a onto a trailer to get into some tight spaces that are even might be a little too small for him as well. So that would be interesting to train a cat. They might be too skittish. I'm not sure. So when we do shoreline inspections in the province, our biologist in Edmonton gives us a list every season of what shorelines he would like to see the dogs inspect. And then we also do what we call veliger monitoring. So veligers are those microscopic mussels, and we can't see those mussels without a microscope. So we take water samples at different locations, at different water bodies, send those to the labs as well, and that helps to increase our monitoring of different water bodies in the province. So some years we do the same lakes as last year, and some years we try to add different lakes into the mix. And that's to do with the pH and the calcium levels in the water that make them higher probability for mussel infestations. All right, well, I hope you guys had enjoyment of that presentation and learned something new about our Conservation Canine program. Like I said, the three videos or four videos are up on YouTube for the Alberta Canine program.